हेलो फ्रेंड्स, लेट स्टार्ट लैब रिपोर्ट इंटरप्रिटेशन। दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक विच कैरीज अराउंड 10 मार्क्स इन योर प्रैक्टिकल एग्जामिनेशन। सो एज पर द एनवीएस प्रैक्टिकल एग्जाम पैटर्न, दिस इज द फर्स्ट ईयर एनवीएस बायोकेमिस्ट्री प्रैक्टिकल एग्जाम मार्क स्ट्रक्चर गिवन बाय एनवीएस। हियर इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ लैब रिपोर्ट्स इन स्पेशल टेक्निक्स, वेयर दे आर मेंशन दैट मिनिमम टू इंटरप्रिटेशन हैज टू बी आस्क्ड। So basically, lab report and special techniques will carry 10 marks each. So this particular session is an objective that at the end of the session, you students will be able to interpret the lab reports, and there will be a separate session on special techniques. So what we have done is we have decided with few representative clinical cases and their lab reports, which will be kept in examination, and not only those lab reports but similar lab reports may be kept in examination. These are just the representative samples of the lab reports, which I mean this is the sample and pattern with which the question, typical question, will be asked about the lab report interpretation. So there are few cases which we have jotted down, and like arterial blood gas analysis. So based on this particular category of case report, here using ABG analysis is asked. Parameters, patient values, and normal reference will be reference ranges will be given to you. Clinical scenario may be given to you or may not be given to you. Basically, the lab report laboratory values will be given to you based on which you have to attempt the questions. Now the questions, depending on the content and depending on the area which each addresses, the marks will be allotted. Like here, there are 5 questions, so total 10 marks, 2 marks each. There might be 4, there might be 3, there might be only 2 questions, 5 marks each. So it depends on the clinical case or depends on the lab report which is asked to do. So like here in this case, these are the lab findings of a hospitalized adult patient. So first question is, what is the acid-base status in this patient? So what we'll look for, we'll look for the pH first. pH is 7.1, which is lower than the normal recommended. So this, it should be acidic, right? Now mention the probable diagnosis. Now giving the probable diagnosis, you'll have to go to remaining parameters, which are the PO2, PCO2 and bicarbonate. Here you'll look for the O2, you'll look for PO2. If it is less than the normal reference range, there is hypoxia kind of thing. PCO2, it is 6.3, so carbon dioxide is not exhaled, it is retained in the body, right? So this might be the reason. So respiratory cause is underlying, and bicarbonate, it is 30. So bicarbonate may be a compensatory mechanism. So probable diagnosis here would be respiratory acidosis. Now, which finding in the report support the diagnosis? Now, what are the findings we have already discussed? Right? PO2, PCO2, pH, bicarbonate and concentration. Now, anion gap is one more thing given here. It is 11.8, normally 7 to 16. Around it is, we take mean 12 as a normal reference range sometimes. But it, when it comes to range, it is 7 to 16. Now, what is the use of anion gap? Will it help us to reach the diagnosis or not? When anion gap is important, if it is metabolic acidosis, it may be high anion gap or normal or low anion gap acidosis, metabolic acidosis. So here it is not of no importance to us so far as our diagnosis is concerned. Rest of the parameters we have addressed. Now go for random blood glucose, urine sugar and urine ketone body. This particular set of investigation is done to rule out the possibility that patient may have diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay, but the glucose was found to be normal, there was no ketone sugar, I mean ketonuria and glycosuria, so the possibility of diabetic ketoacidosis is ruled out. So this clear cut diagnosis is respiratory acidosis. Now which other investigation should be done in this patient? What else is left? Can you Can you identify the investigation which can be done in case of acidosis or alkalosis?
Yeah.
Correct. So it may be serum electrolytes, urine pH should have been done. Okay, which are the serum electrolytes to be done? Sodium, potassium and chloride. Because it is anion germination here, the necessity of sodium, potassium and chloride ion concentration is important. So this was the case for arterial blood gas analysis. See, the parameters may be changed, questions may be changed, but overall interpretation of the arterial blood gas analysis is will be like this. So go for pH first, C for PO2, C for PCO2, C for bicarbonate ions. Doesn't matter whether anion gap is given or not. You may be given electrolytes also and not anion gap. And other relevant or supporting findings like random blood glucose, urine sugar, then urine getting bodies may be given to you. You may be given urine pH as well. Okay? So this is what the blood gas analysis parameters are. Coming to urine report. Now most important thing is, when you come in examination, you always ask, sir, urine report is for normal urine or abnormal urine. So when it comes to urine report and you are asked to interpret the given urine report, if it is a question of laboratory lab report interpretation, I am not telling you about qualitative estimation of urine. So it is lab report interpretation, then the urine report may be of normal individual or individual with some disease. So that should be in your mind, that the parameters which you are looking for and the values you are comparing with the normal reference ranges, you may find that it may be of normal person, normal individual or a disease individual. So what are the basic things you look for? The necessary points of your interpretation should be key points from the physical properties, key results from the chemical test and the possible pathology coinciding with those key results. Like here, in this urine report, what is the standard urine report format, which will be containing identification of patient, which will have name, age, sex, date and time of sample collection, date and time of reporting result, registration number and referred by so and so doctor. So the physical properties, these are the 7 physical properties which are mentioned in your journal and you have been attempting this when you analyze urine samples. So what is that? Appearance. Here in this case it is clear, volume is 60 mm, color, it is deep yellow. What is the normal urine color? Okay, so compare with the normal reference ranges or the normally observed values. Odor is aromatic, it is not ammoniacal, pH is slightly acidic. Since normal acidic specific gravity is 1.015, it falls in the normal reference range. Total solid dissolved is 39.9 grams per liter. 2.6 is the Mohs coefficient. Chemical properties, protein as it says, absent. These are the tests done. It will be better if you follow this format of urine report in your examination. Okay, proteins are absent, glucose genetic test absent, benzene test is negative, bile salt present, bile pigments present, respectively a hair sulfur flower test and positive test are given, the test positive, ketone bodies, orthorax test is negative, acetone bodies are absent, and the consolidated result is the abnormal constituent present on the given urine sample is bile salt and the bile pigment. Okay, so this is how you have to consolidate the result based on your physical properties, key points from the physical properties and key results from the chemical test and the possible pathology. Now here the most important thing, the question will be asked, interpret the given urine report. Now this urine report is given to you along with the abnormal constituents. Now you know the abnormal constituents, you know the physical properties. Now you have to interpret it. Interpretation means you will be writing the conditions in which bile salts and the bile pigments are present in urine. Normally they are not present, but you know these are the abnormal constituents of urine. So it may be blood, it may be glucose, it may be protein or a combination of these 6 abnormal constituents. So based on the positive constituent found, you have to interpret the urine report. Then coming to the next thing, that is pancreatitis. Now when it comes to pancreas and pancreatic function test, we do two enzymes, serum amylase and serum lipase for pancreatic function. As far as the case is concerned, a 40-year-old female presented with infertility with constant multiple gastric pain, nausea and vomiting. Now clinical scenario is not directly pointing you towards a clear cut diagnosis. It may be because of gastritis also, it may be because of some obstruction in the intestine. Now you have to do the laboratory investigation. The lab findings are in front of you. The liver enzymes, AST, ALT, these are within normal, slightly elevated, but it is near about normal. ALP is 122, it is also slightly less, but that can be, that may be normal. Incidentally, it was found higher. Cholesterol, it is 176, it is also normal. Amylase, it is high. Lipase, it is high. Okay, sorry for the repetition of AST and ALT. What is the probable diagnosis? Now when you know that amylase and lipase are high, what can be the probable diagnosis? Maybe pancreatitis. But question may be asked, why is it not chylomicronemia or something like that related to salivary gland? Because lipase is specific for the pancreas. If amylase and lipase both are increasing, it has to be from the pancreas. What is the cause of elevated level of serum amylase and serum lipase? So that you have learned in general enzymology, that lysis or increased permeability of the pancreatic cells due to infection or inflammation, these cells on the pancreas are normally also releasing amylase and lipase, but when these cells are undergoing inflammation or infection, they release it more quantity because the permeability of the cell wall increases, or the cell may be lysed. Now, third question, comment on all other biochemical parameters. Now, we have seen that the parameters like liver enzymes, cholesterol, these are marginally raised. Okay? So, are they significant? It may be, because pancreas and hepatobiliary system, these are adjacent. Right? And sometimes the obstruction of the bile canalicula, bile duct, common bile duct and pancreatitis, they coexist. So we do liver function test and pancreatic function test together. Which other test you would suggest to confirm the diagnosis? Now liver enzymes and pancreatic enzymes we have done. To confirm the diagnosis, we can go for like stool elastase, stool chymotrypsin, we can go for detection of stool fat, because if pancreatic enzymes are not there, lipase is not there, amylase is not there, if it is lipase, there is possibility that you will find fat globules in the patient's stools. Okay, so chymotrypsin will be absent, elastase activity will not be seen in the stool. Even you can go for sweat chloride test as well, because cystic fibrosis may coexist with the pancreatitis. Coming to cystinuria, laboratory findings of 18-year young boy with complaints of hematuria and severe pain in lower right flank. Urine analysis showed elevated levels of cysteine, ornithine, arginine and lysine, and hexagonal crystals were found in urine microscopy. X-ray showed presence of stones in the kidney. Now it is a case of kidney stones. Okay? And the clinical scenario or the urine report, actually it is not in the form of a report, but it is saying that the elevated levels of cysteine, ornithine, arginine and lysine are seen, and hexagonal crystals are also found in microscopy. So this report is of importance. So what can be the probable diagnosis? We know cysteine can form urine stone. It forms hexagonal crystals. And when cysteine is getting excreted, if it is in high concentration in blood, what is the role of ornithine, arginine and lysine there? Okay, why are they excreted? And are they not forming stones? No, they are not forming stones. Only stones are formed because of cysteine precipitation. Ornithine, arginine, and lysine, they share the common transport system with this basic amino acid. So defect in the transport system of this amino acid results in increased excretion in urine. What is the cause of the disorder? That we have answered. Cysteine is relatively insoluble. As we have said, it is relatively insoluble. It has a tendency to precipitate forming stones in the kidney and urinary tract. The hexagonal crystals are typically observed in the microscope, and so these are opalous, radio opaque, and these are the stones found in the X-ray. Now, which test can be performed to confirm the diagnosis? It is cyanide hematocrysate test, which we perform to confirm the diagnosis. Which diet plan, again, like in case of phenylketonuria or cystinuria, when these amino acids are excreted, this type of question may be asked, what diet plan can be suggested to the patient? So, if that particular amino acid is getting excreted, we have to restrict the amino acid or the proteins containing that amino acid in the diet. Dietary intake of cysteine may be reduced, drinking large quantities of water so that cysteine doesn't get precipitated and get excreted. And moreover, we can go for alkalinizing the urine by administering sodium bicarbonate so that the pH is altered and the cysteine doesn't get precipitated in the form of stones. So it will be in the soluble form and it will be excreted through the urine without precipitation. Okay. Now coming to well-known case of diabetic ketoacidosis, you must have gone through this report many a times during your practical. Practical and EC was also there on diabetes, so you know the laboratory report interpretation for diabetic ketoacidosis very well. But to address the case which we have taken, so we will go through the question. What is the probable diagnosis? Obviously, it is diabetic ketoacidosis. What is the cause of elevated levels of fasting blood glucose? Now, you have to tell here the cause. Means it may be type 1 or type 2, right? So, decreased insulin secretion or insulin resistance may be the cause. Third question is comment on all other biochemical parameters. Now, apart from blood glucose, what are the other parameters? We have kept the diagnosis of diabetic ketoacidosis. And we have a question wise, we have not gone through the report first. Now here, arterial pH 7.2, so it is acidosis, anion gap it is 11, okay, so it is less than 10 millimole per liter, normal. So it is serum bicarbonate is 16, is not concentrated yet. Urine analysis says glucose is present and ketone bodies are present in urine. Glycosuria and ketoneuria, it confirms the diagnosis of diabetic ketoacidosis. Along with that, you know, electrolytes are also given. Sodium is 148, more than the normal reference range, and potassium is within the normal reference range. Okay. Which other test you would suggest to confirm the diagnosis? What are the additional investigations which can be done? We can go for serum insulin. We can go for C-peptide assay to find out whether it is decreased insulin, because we are treating this patient with insulin because it has come in emergency. Had we known the previous history, that is okay. If it is not known, we have to go for serum insulin and C-peptide to decide the further management of the patient. The familial hypercholesterolemia. Now, this particular case was taken to give you an idea about lipid profile lab reports. A 35-year-old obese female patient reported to OPD for general health checkup. This is not an emergency condition. Lipid profile is almost always done in on elective basis, OPD basis. Her obesity laboratory workup revealed following findings. Serum cholesterol 356. What is the normal? Less than 200 is the normal. PG 185, that is also raised. LDL, it is raised. HDL, it is normal. VLDL, it is slightly increased. What is the probable diagnosis? here there are, if you go through the Friedreich's classification, to go to the perfect diagnosis, we have to see which are the parameters increased. Cholesterol, TGA is increased, LDL increased, except HDL, everything is increased. Whether marginally or whether increases more, but the parameter is increased. So that is the case of familial hypercholesterolemia. To be very specific, it is type 2B because all four are increased. Which what may be the metabolic defect? It is increased ApoB and ApoC2, which leads to this kind of defect. Which finding in the report support the diagnosis? Then we have discussed these things. Increase LDL, VLDL, TG and cholesterol, all four are right. Which other investigation should be done in this patient? Now, to evaluate the obesity, this is the primitive panel of lipid profile, which has to be done in case of obesity or in case of CHDN, etc. The obesity can be associated with metabolic syndrome, we know this. But metabolic syndrome, it may be PCOS also. So the further work of the thyroid function test, because in case of hypothyroidism, you may see obesity. Liver function test should be done, and diabetes investigation should be done, like blood glucose, serum insulin, HbA1c, because obesity may be associated with diabetes also, diabetes mellitus also. So it should be done. The patient is female, screening investigation we can prescribe for PCOS, okay? Because it is 35 years old female, so it is in the reproductive age, okay? Coming to gout, now it is for serum uric acid. Coming to the case, laboratory findings of 38-year young male with mild fever and pain in this right metatarsophalangeal joint, human colleague and a swollen big toe are as below. Clinical history is suggestive of gout, okay, but we'll go through the lab report first. Serum creatinine 0.8, it is less, it is normal. Blood urea, it is also normal. Serum uric acid is 12, which is more than the normal ranges, normal reference ranges. Urine pH is 4.2, okay, is less than the normal reference range specified for urine pH. Serum creatinine, this point, this is the reflection. What is the likely diagnosis? Is gout. Elevated level of uric acid clearly indicates that. What is the pathogenesis of this condition? Elevated level of serum uric acid results in precipitation of uric acid crystals in the joint. Formation of uric crystals is associated because why there is precipitation of uric acid crystals? Because the temperature is less than the body temperature in joint cavity. Along with that, the pH differences and temperature, if it is low, it causes precipitation of uric acid in the joint cavity. Especially when the levels of uric acid are more. For this, if it exceeds solubility of the uric acid. How will you confirm the diagnosis? Diagnosis is confirmed by demonstrating the presence of porphyria and monosodium urate crystals in the synovial fluid with histopathological examination. This is the confirmatory test. How is this case managed? A patient can be treated with allopurinol, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. You know the inhibitor, suicidal inhibitor, that is allopurinol, it is only used. Biochemical findings seen in 35-year young patient of a case of hemolytic jaundice. Now coming to the lab report, if you go through, total bilirubin is raised, conjugated is also raised, unconjugated is more, rise in unconjugated bilirubin is more. Okay. Liver enzymes are normal, all three, alkaline phosphatase, AST, ALT, these are normal. Mean bile salts,
bile pigment which are negative, so it goes towards hemolytic variant of jaundice. Urobilinogen is positive, fecal sarcoglycogen is positive, so there is no obstruction, right? So the diagnosis is very clear. It is hemolytic jaundice. What will be the cause of the disease? It may be because of increased rate of hemolysis. Now there are many causes of hemolysis of RBC. So you can enumerate those causes here for hemolytic jaundice. It may be a RBC defect. It may be because of hemoglobin, hemoglobinopathies leading to hemolysis. It may be membrane disorders, RBC membrane disorders like hereditary spherocytosis leading to hemolysis. It may be external factors like drugs which lead to hemolysis. Third question, comment on all the biochemical parameters. Now we have gone through all the like liver enzymes, we have gone for urine parameters also, and fecal sarcoglycogen also. So these were very normal reference ranges. Okay. Comment on urine analysis and give the probable cause. Okay, specifically for urine parameters. Right? Now these urine parameters are not altered, that you have to specify. Known case of partial thought. This is a lab report given of a 2.5-year-old male child with edema on legs and hands. So values are the these are the values of the laboratory report. Like they did fasting blood glucose, it was low. So it was a marginal hypoglycemic case. Hemoglobin 7.5, serum total protein was 4.6, less than normal reference range, specific for the age. Serum albumin it is 1.8. It is also less. Sodium is also less. Hyponatremia, potassium is also less. So it is because of protein deficiency. Clear cut protein deficiency is there. So this is the case of partial. So question one is comment on the above blood reports that we did commented. What is the probable diagnosis? We know the diagnosis. Mention the cause of the disease. Now cause of the disease, as we know, Kwashiorkor is the acute condition of protein energy malnutrition. It does not manifest itself, some infection, some diarrhea, some respiratory tract infection. When immunity decreases drastically, in those conditions Kwashiorkor gets manifested. Okay, so this is the cause of the disease. You have to write in detail. Depends on the marks for which the question is asked. Mention the cause of edema on the legs and hands. That you know, decreased albumin, reduced oncotic pressure. Next case of myocardial infarction. The parameters of related to myocardial infarction and additional parameters which need to be done. So these are the right type of question asked in myocardial infarction. So let us take the case. A 54-year-old male patient reported to OPD with intermittent mild chest pain referring to neck for last 1 day. Along with the clinical examination and ECG, laboratory investigations were done as follows. LDH was raised, creatine phosphokinase was also raised, MB isoenzyme is also raised of creatine phosphokinase. So it is the case of myocardial infarction. The first question is interpret the given laboratory report and mention the probable diagnosis that we have done. In this particular question, to write answer, you have to write the clinical scenario, some points in the clinical scenario as well, which led you to the diagnosis and from the laboratory findings. Which other intervention should be done? So what are the clinical points, key points? Let me tell you, intermittent mild chest pain, typically referring to the neck. Okay, age is 54-year-old male patient susceptible to the infarction, most of the cases are male, and typically referring to the neck is the pain of myocardial infarction. Which other investigation should be done in this patient? As we know, only 3 investigations have been done. ECG also, at the moment the report has not been given those. What are the other investigations to be done? we can go for cardiac troponin, and obviously the complete lipid profile has to be done. And for the further worker, when we go for serum apolipoproteins and serum homocysteine levels as well. Coming to the case of phenylketonuria, laboratory report of 3-year young, fair, chubby child, light colored hair, skin, and eyes. Now, if the investigation is phenylalanine, so that is the probable diagnosis goes towards phenylketonuria. But see the values whether they are normal or not. Now, blood phenylalanine is 35 mg per deciliter, more than normal reference. Guthrie's bacterial inhibition assay was positive. Perchloride test was positive, and plasma glucose, it was normal. So ferrochloride test was not, was positive, and it was not because of the releasing sugar present. It was positive because of phenylpyruvate and phenylacid and phenyllactate. Okay. Now Guthrie's bacterial inhibition test, inhibition assay is positive. Means it was inhibition. Okay. There was inhibition. Yeah, certain strains of Bacillus subtilis require phenylalanine for their optimum growth. When the medium is devoid of the phenylalanine, bacteria cannot grow on it. Okay, the medium is devoid of. But if urine is added to the medium, or patient's urine is added to the medium, it will show you the growth. So, if the growth is there, that means patient's urine contains phenylalanine. Okay, second question, what is the possible cause of this disorder? You know the enzyme deficiency. Okay, so those three enzyme deficiency you have to note here as a possible cause of the disorder. What is the cause of light hair and skin and eyes due to impaired synthesis of melanin that you have to put? From tyrosine. Yeah. Second strains, what is the significance of Guthrie's bacterial inhibition assay that we just have discussed, that Bacillus subtilis requires phenylalanine for optimum growth. Okay, and when the medium is devoid of phenylalanine, the bacteria cannot grow on it. But patient's urine contains phenylalanine and bacteria grow. Into renal glycosuria. Here in this case, if you go through the report, you see hemoglobin is normal, blood glucose is 80, that is normal. Postprandial blood glucose was also normal, but urine showed presence of sugar. So you know, it's a case of renal glycosuria, because despite fasting and postprandial blood glucose levels normal, the urine sugar was found to be positive. What is the probable diagnosis of renal glycosuria? How will you further investigate? So what else can be done? Now if it is renal glycosuria, that means it was a renal pathology underlying. So you can evaluate renal functions of the particular patient. So what are the tests you go for? The serum creatinine, B1, serum electrolytes can be done. So for complete workup for the kidney function test to be done. So one more test from the glycogen storage use is the metabolic storage disorder. So these kind of cases can also be asked. Like these cases are mostly as a clinical case. But when you know the lab reports and the supported clinical conditions are also given to you, these questions can be kept in the laboratory report investigation interpretation exercise. So coming to the case, laboratory findings for a fasting blood sample of 12-year-old girl child who had a grossly enlarged abdomen with complaints of weakness, sweating, and pallor. Okay. So what are the lab reports? First, let us see that fasting blood glucose, it was low, so patient was hypoglycemic. Blood pH slightly acidic. Lactate to 30, which is increased so much. Total ketone bodies 6 mg per deciliter. This is serum value of ketone bodies. Serum triglycerides 400 increased to that extent. Serum uric acid is 12. So what is the probable diagnosis? Let us go to the clinical case first. Key point from the clinical scenario. Grossly enlarged abdomen. Maybe hepatomegaly, maybe splenomegaly. right? With complaints of weakness, sweating and pallor. If it is weakness, laboratory finding shows you hypoglycemia. It may be because of hypoglycemia, right? Sweating and pallor.
Yeah.
It may be because of hemoglobin may be low, so it shows pallor. Now, blood pH is acidic, lactate is increased, ketone bodies are also increased, uric acid is increased, okay, with hepatomegaly. So the diagnosis goes towards glycogen storage disorder, okay, and you have to identify the disorder with hypoglycemia. There are disorders with hypoglycemia, disorder with normal glucose. So the disorder with hypoglycemia with acidic pH and lactate and uric acid raised is typically your type 1 glycogen storage disease, that is Langer disease. I will interpret the laboratory report that we have already done. What is the cause of elevated serum TG? Yeah. You know, glucose 6 phosphate is accumulated, right? It is diverted for other pathways causing serum triglyceride synthesis. Okay. What is the cause of elevated serum uric acid? Now we know glucose 6 phosphate is diverted to HNT shunt, leading to increased production of pentose sugar. So pentose sugar is increased the synthesis of PRPP and enhancing the synthesis and degradation of purine nucleotides leading to uric acid synthesis. And moreover, the lactic acid synthesized competes with uric acid for its excretion. So synthesis of uric acid is more and its excretion is less. So the extent of increase in uric acid in case of one of the disease is more. So these were the cases. These were the cases and laboratory reports which gave you an idea how to interpret the lab reports. Not only for this exercise particularly, but this interpretation of laboratory reports will help you in solving or attempting the clinical case scenarios as well. Okay, and not only this, but this may help you in writing interpretation for your quantitative estimations as well. Yeah, thank you very much. For any query, we will be creating a group in which you have to write your queries, and we will try to solve the queries to our best. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.